Greetings, fellow travelers. I am Extro. I movie, therefore I am. First one is The Man from Hong Kong from 1975, directed by Brian Trenchard Smith. It's his first theatrical movie, I believe, and it's on Blu-ray now, thanks to this fairly epic release from Umbrella, Australian releasing company. Well, Man from Hong Kong, this is a hell of a thing. So, here's a movie I have been hearing about for years and have wanted to see. I just couldn't or didn't, a combination of both. I don't know, I just never had the chance to do so. Then, it shows up. It just shows up on my doorstep. Just like that, it's a Christmas present from your friend and mine, Explosive Action. And I was tickled. Absolutely tickled. And there was much rejoicing.
Yay!
He had shown it in an update, and I was completely sold on it. I knew I was finally going to get to see this thing. But it was the holidays, I had no spare cash, so I also knew it was going to have to wait. Then, like I said, it just shows up. That is just awesome. So, thank you, Explosive Action, for that. A kind present on any scale, and I appreciate you thinking of me, man. But as it turned out, this thing blew my doors off. I mean, as much hope as I had for it, and that was a fair amount, it was just, it was so much better than my highest expectation. The only thing I don't like about this movie is that I didn't see it much, much sooner. Golden Harvest and Brian Trenchard Smith. Well, that's a combination. Wang Yu stars as the character of the title and was apparently an even bigger jerk than the few stories I had previously heard had indicated, but whatever. Movies and movies. Life is one thing, an important thing, but this is movies, man, so you want to hear all the details on that, it's in the extras. Okay, as it gets going, Sammo Hung, no less, gets in a fight on top of Ayers Rock while a helicopter chases a car at high speed down the road. There's face kicking, boulder throwing, and of course, an explosion. All this before the titles even roll, okay? Then, when the titles do roll, it's Wang Yu being a badass in Hong Kong while a hang glider sails into his police training yard and 70s super hit Sky High by Jigsaw plays in the background. Oh, people, I knew I was going to have a good time. I knew I was going to have a really good time. it was going to happen. So anyway, okay, let me skip that. Wang Yu is sent to Australia. He's an inspector. He's there to extradite a criminal. That young Sammo Hung from the beginning. He's there to extradite him back to Hong Kong. But before he can do that, and after a brutal fight with Sammo is shot dead by a henchman hired to protect a powerful drug smuggling munitions hoarding baddie somewhere up the top of the local criminal chain. All right, of course Wang Yu feels cheated and is angry about his interrupted duty and is off to do his Chinese Dirty Harry thing throughout Australia for the rest of the running time, only taking long enough breaks to bleed or to bed down the fairer locals, which is where I was going with the reporter thing earlier, okay? And with a little James Bond flavor, just for good times and giggles, this all goes down almost non-stop from what I've described all the way to the end. This was 100 flavors of badass from top to bottom, and all done with that uniquely Brian Trenchard Smith brand of darkly comic undertones. Like, early on, he's talking to a female reporter that I mentioned earlier, and she asks him, "What's so special about the special branch?" He says, "Come on, I can show you." Cut to, boinking. Or that Wang Yu Sammo Hung fight I mentioned. Wang Yu kicks Sammo right in the berry bag, hard. Cut to, pool table at the moment of a break. It's got that kind of humor. Man, it's fantastic. It really plays well. It's a beautiful, beautiful thing. And there's more straightforward fist-clenching, yeah, kind of moments as well. like after a throwdown with George Lazenby and his thugs at a public function, where Wang Yu has no choice but to leave, he gets asked, "What are you going to do now?" He just says, "More." Yeah! It's just like that all the way through, minus one hilarious romantic montage, which, although great, is great in a different way. It's really hilarious, okay? Is this what people in love do in Australia in the 70s? They pretend to shoot themselves while standing on top of walls. They get stuck in metal tubes giggling while some chick on the soundtrack sings about love. Okay, whatever. I'll go with it, because after the montage, more boinking. It's greatness, this movie. It's got a funktastic score, a thoroughly 70s vibe. I mean, wow, it's great. If you're into that, and you guys know I'm into that, that's this movie gets there. Brutal fights, eye-opening stunts, of course. It's cool to the core, and I love it. Absolutely love it. I should also mention the car chase. This thing, it reminded me of an Italian crime film car chase. That's how cool it was. Okay, side-mounted shots, low to the ground, aerial stuff, a real sense of danger, just fantastic. And, oh, there are so many extras on this. It'll make you do a double take because, oh, look at that. All right, well, I really rambled on this one here, I'm now noticing. So I guess I'll just have to say, yeah, there's certainly a whole lot of extras on this. I got to mention at least the inclusion of several more Brian Trenchard Smith films. Several more films, just as a bonus. It really is an epic edition. It's amazing. So obviously, reversible cover, of course, I'm going to have to give this the very high recommendation. And sincere thanks one more time to Explosive Action for the Christmas thought. Really do appreciate that. If you can pause and see that, I don't know if it's going to work out, but I'll give it a shot. It's The Man from Hong Kong, starring the man from Shaw and the man from Bond, from The Man from Australia. Awesome. How do you follow up The Man from Hong Kong? Well, I'm going to follow it up with Matengo. Matengo, Attack of the Mushroom People. That's the American title. It's directed by Ishiro Honda. That's right. And released in Toho in 1963. This is the Tokyo Shock disc, released in 2005, I'm pretty sure it was. And that line of Toho movies that Tokyo Shock was releasing were quite a shock, truthfully. And seeing the Japanese versions of them, of these films, all these films they released, the way they were meant to be seen, was a real treat. They did the discs justice. This is one of the very few I skipped right here, though. I wasn't even sure I wanted it. I caught it somewhere as a kid. I don't remember where. I just remember thinking, eh, you know? For a kid expecting a creature feature sitting in front of the tube for a 2-hour time slot, ready for that monster movie, the multi-layered, subtext-rich, Americanized human drama that unfolded for the first hour or so with commercials was more than enough to convince me I needed to be somewhere else as quickly as possible. And that was it. That's part of the trouble with some of the names these things got here as well. I mean, Attack of the Mushroom People. I was ready for something, I don't know what, something along the lines of maybe Navy versus the Night Monsters or Attack of the Giant Leeches or something. And this was not that, all right? So after a lot of random conversations over the years, one friend in particular really pushed for this. He was convinced I would really love this movie if I just watched it again. I decided I wanted it. I wanted to give it another chance, after all. But then it was too late. It was out of print. That's how it goes, right? I figured I'd wait. Yeah. It just got more expensive. But patience has finally paid off, and here it is. Got it brand new and sealed for a completely reasonable price. And now, after all these years, I can say that it really is a very strong and rewarding movie. Go figure. And the first two-thirds, with the people changing into what they really are, character-wise, that's what makes the whole thing work. Then in the final third, when things get, you know, nightmarish and bizarre, I don't know if you can make it out there, It's a real thrill to watch it all unfold. Now, mushroom people? Yes, but not the way it sounds exactly. It sounds like you could put it with killer tomatoes or something, but you can't. This is no kids' movie, even if they tried to turn it into one here, originally. It's handled maturely, it has a real story to tell, and though this altered fungus is a very real danger, it's not silly, not at all. You don't get that vibe while watching it at all. It's creepy, man. I'm serious. So, if you were put off in any similar way to me, then I'm here to urge you to give it a revisit as well, or a chance, if you never have. It's a fine film. Weirdly, you can spot the influence of Matango in a lot of really interesting places. I mean, Gilgen's Island? The influence is there in a huge way, the characters. Erotic Nights of the Living Dead occurred to me within the first few minutes, but that kind of went away. I mean, yeah, you know. Maybe there's a lot of uncredited influence. Maybe it's all a coincidence, but it is fun to think about. So, the disc is a nice anamorphic print, Japanese with English subtitles or English dubbing. It says it's there. I didn't even click it. I assume it's there. Commentary by one of the lead actors. Interview with the special effects cinematographer that lasts almost a half an hour. Really interesting. And a feature, what's it called? A feature called Spoken Word from the Matango writer, which is actually also very interesting. Trailers round it all out as always, and the only bad thing I can say is once again that I waited so long to give in to the temptation. And if you've seen the movie, that's a hilarious joke. Yep, that phrasing was on purpose. I give it a shot. Matango, recommended. Check out Matango. This next one. Now, I don't know if it's absolutely necessary for me to show this since I don't have much new to offer. But like I said a few videos back, it's fun to show some of these, and I just want to sometimes, just because I want to, you know? Not out of any feeling that people especially wanted my take on it or need to hear this from me or even that I have something worthwhile to offer to begin with. Just want to. This is one of those. So you've been warned. It is the Hellraiser collection, the Scarlet Box from Arrow. Now, I skipped this when the import was around, and I nearly skipped it again when it came out here, which was a big surprise to me, actually. But my wife is a huge fan and was pushing for it anyway. Right about the time that conversation happened, it went on sale. An amazing sale, I thought, from Amazon, just over $60. Which is the lowest price I've seen the set go for either here or in the UK. So, with that and her urging, I pulled the trigger, and here it is. Now, at the risk of alienating some people, I am not a huge fan of the original. I know. Relax, it's all right. I know that's offensive and it's wrong and all those other things you were thinking between calling me names, that's fine. I think it's important to a certain degree, I think it's innovative. But there's just something I've always found really off-putting about the first movie. The effects are outstanding, the score, all that. But man, Hellraiser, this is two-thirds a heavy drama about a broken family made up of differently damaged people. That's what it is. And I get that now, after seeing some of the interviews, that's what he was going for. But I don't know. After that, it's all about lust and adultery. Which gets semi-interestingly sharpened with a supernatural edge. And it's just about passionless lusting for sex and the effect that has on many local dirty cheating husbands, you know? I mean, that's what it really is. You take out the Cenobite angle altogether, and it's like an episode of one of those murder reenactment shows on late night TV or something. Then comes the final third, and of course, I enjoy that just fine. When it cuts loose, wow. But really, for me, it all serves as setup for the masterpiece that is Hellraiser 2 Hellbound. Man, do I love that one. I love that movie. Always have. I think it's the finest movie in the series. I better get to showing this here. Horror excellence for me, and there's even part three, which I personally like a little better now than I used to. I had some problems with it originally, but I think it's better now. Many, many extras. So, Hellraiser, they come like this, and there are a few. See, there's, let's see, part two. Okay, and then, yeah, part three. Yeah, I don't even know why I'm bothering to do this. I'm sure you've seen it all a bunch of times. The Clive Barker Legacy discs and the poster and cards and all that kind of thing. The Legacy disc is, it's loaded, by the way. I mean loaded. It comes with this hardback book. Real book. Oh, and that at the bottom, which is cool. Book is fantastic, actually. Can't discredit that at all. So it is, it's an arguably impressive set. And even though in a way I was kind of, for me personally, paying that much money basically for part two, it was very cool to go through them again. Let's see, anything on the back is with that design. Is that so? Yeah, the extras, there are so many extras, an amount so overwhelming you might refer to it as almost a ridiculous amount of extras. They really went all out. If you love extras, this will keep you going for a long time, no doubt. Anyway, I guess I sort of wanted to get all that part one stuff off my chest and just show that, yeah, I got it, I got one. It's an impressive set, like I said, but my wife is certainly going to get more enjoyment out of it than me, and probably going to reach for it a lot more often than I will, I think. Hellbound notwithstanding. So, there you go. The Hellraiser Scarlet Box. Here comes the Time Walker. Reflective Time Walker. Bam. 1982. One of the Scream Factory Blu-ray exclusives you need to order directly from their site. Limited to 1,000 copies, I believe. And I checked last night because I decided I was going to include this one. And it is still available. Not all of them are, but this one is. This stars Ben Murphy, Nina Axelrod, and James Caan, with smaller roles from Melissa Prophet, Kevin Brophy, Sherry Belafonte, even reuniting Austin Stoker and Darwin Jostin from Assault on Precinct 13, which is very cool and very fun, if you're into that. Also, Warrington Gillette, who will probably always be best remembered for playing Jason Voorhees in Friday the 13th Part 2. So it's got a good cast. It's an incredibly fluid, emotional, impressive bit of soundtracking on this movie from Richard Band, one of his finer scores, I think, honestly. And some of the great PG-rated violence and light nudity that existed before PG became something different. Now, the movie itself. All right. Yeah. So, mummies, aliens, flesh-eating space fungus, and the kinds of special effects I just never get tired of seeing. So, why? Why the hate? I don't know. I really don't. I've never understood the ease with which Time Walker is completely dismissed, or more appropriately, just cast aside. Fortunately, Scream saw past that and took a chance, and I guess it was really taking a chance. I can't be the only one that this makes this happy. I mean, I can't be, can I? Man, I hope not. So, a sarcophagus is discovered in a newly revealed corner of King Tut's tomb and brought back to a university in the U.S. Lots of strange things reveal themselves during the cursory inspection, but it isn't until a super douchebag driven by a bit of thievery combined with some high-dose radiation happens, the combination happens, that stuff takes place, and our friend, the Time Walker, is up and about, floating about the grounds to reclaim what belongs to him and him alone. Why? Gotta check out the movie and find out. People are very, very hard on this movie, though. I have loved it since day one. I really have. I still do. But knowing how people react to it, if you haven't seen it, I can't really give it a recommendation, even though I kind of want to anybody who isn't already familiar with it. The reason being, so few people seem to be able to enjoy it. And although I just don't get that, that's the way it is. It has an open ending, which promises more. But sadly, and of course, that never came to be. What it does have, it has some great shots and some great set pieces, a wonderful mood, and an interesting story. I was discussing it a bit, and found out it was a popular Mystery Science Theater 3000 episode. I didn't know that. Maybe that's got something to do with its reputation. I'm guessing a lot of people saw it that way first, and because of that, it's impossible for them to now take it at all seriously. I was never a fan of that show because, yeah, I know, I just offended more people. Because I liked so many of the movies. I liked so much of what they chose to make fun of so hard. I figured out early on that it just wasn't a show for me. I like the movies. I want to enjoy the movies. I don't want to hear all that while I'm trying to watch the movie. Well, I guess if you like what you've heard and haven't seen the Mystery Science Theater episode, then maybe it's worth looking into. At least check out a trailer and see if it's something you want to go further with. I love it, though, a lot. Comes with the trailer and two interviews, one with the producer and one with the actor Kevin Brophy. And it looks great. I think it looks pretty good. This is this is a 1982 low-budget movie that nobody seems to care about, and they did a respectable job on it. So I'm grateful, personally. Tom Walker. Now, The Ripper Blood Pack. A DVD set featuring 1985 slow-moving but now infamous Blood Cult. Its 1986 sequel, Revenge, aka Blood Cult 2, I believe. I'm pretty sure I saw it packaged that way at some point, Blood Cult 2. And the equally infamous 1986 release of The Ripper. That movie that Savini did and is more than anxious to crap all over with extreme prejudice these days. I mean, it's not that I don't get it, I'm just saying. So, I think I might have shown this set, sort of, way back in the day. But again, I'm just not sure. But it doesn't matter. I'm not showing this set to discuss them regardless, so it's fine, because I'm pretty sure I showed it. The reason I wanted to include this set in the update is because, bam, look at that. Regular sized case. Yep. Originally, it came in a double case, and many people received rattling discs loose when they bought it, myself included, twice. Scratched up discs that you buy new make my OCD itch, so I couldn't live with it. I tried again, the same thing happened, different disc, it was annoying. So, I ran across this re-released version here that comes in a nice and secure regular case, where all the discs managed to stay connected to their holders. Yeah, so I figured I'd show it in case it mattered to anybody else as much as it mattered to me. As for the movies, hey man, you know, check it out. They are what they are. That's what they are. Gory direct-to-video shenanigans from the mid-80s, made for less than Schwarzenegger's daily cigar budget, I'm sure. All right? And that's what they are. Chances are that if you're into this sort of thing, then you already know about these and have decided on all three of them, one way or the other. I enjoy two of them. Very much. Can you guess which one I can't get behind? Do you even care? Probably not. Okay, so moving on, that's that. Ripper Blood Pack, where the DVDs actually stay in place. Okay, that's what I'm showing. So definitely worth updating if you received damaged discs. The Ripper Blood Pack regular DVD case. Yeah, man, so that was a weird one, wasn't it? Some stuff that should have been shorter was very, very long, and some stuff that should have probably been longer was very, very short, and something got updated simply because it came in a regular DVD case. Yep, you just never know what you're gonna get on the Extro, the Mutilator, happy, feeling good vibes, feel good movie time video picture show, right? Hopefully I can restore some balance for the next update, but, you know, we'll see, right? Until then, yeah. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you later. I like to be the center of attraction. Let the people know just who I am. Like my movie shows with lots of action. Take my fear straight from the can. 'Cause I'm a man.